Enlisted or officer? Which one's for you and which one's easier or harder? I was enlisted and I don't know which one would be harder, but enlisted, let's see.
I get asked all the time, what's harder, being an officer or being enlisted? The answer is complicated, so let me provide you with some considerations about garrison duties, deployed duties, being the boss versus not being the boss, lifestyle, rank has its privileges, and fun factor.
It sure does. Sure does, but it also has downsides too.
In the interest of full disclosure, I've already made a video about the differences between officers and enlisted and considerations for enlisting or getting a commission. So if you're interested in learning about timeline and educational requirements, commitments, roles and responsibilities, it would be unreal to discuss what's harder. As far as jobs and duties, there is obviously a huge spectrum within the U.S. military. For example,
many.
It would be unreasonable to compare an Air Force sergeant who spent his career translating Russian and never deployed one day to a war zone with a special forces officer who spent his entire career deploying and training for war. This is like comparing a Girl Scout to a member of the FBI SWAT team.
Comparing a translator to a Girl Scout, that's pretty messed up, man. That's pretty messed up because they do a lot of good covert work.
A doctor and a medic in a hospital are going to spend their time in a clinic, sometimes in a fancy clinic in garrison, and sometimes in an improvised clinic when deployed. That. But either way, their lives are tied to medical duties and inside work. Similarly, a finance officer or a finance NCO, a lawyer or a judge advocate general or a JAG officer, or a JAG NCO are going to spend their days with their heads in a book or in a computer. So to standardize this conversation, let's talk about combat arms officers and NCOs or non-commissioned officers. These are tankers, infantrymen, special forces, and we will do so by starting with garrison duties. Garrison is the word we use to describe duties back at your home station. Let me simplify by saying that a junior officer spends 25% of his time doing admin duties and 75% of his time training. This is about as good as it gets. Admin duties include attending intelligence consulting but required briefings like SHARP and EO and gender training.
Are they conducting it? They're conducting it. I never had an officer conduct a SHARP or EO. It was always delegated to the sergeant.
It involves planning training, monitoring the budget, property accountability, writing evaluations, writing awards. The 75% training time is individual training, like PT, learning a new weapon, drills at the range. And then comes collective training, like live fire training, doing field training exercises, and participating in evaluations and validation exercises. For the mid-grade officer, let's say captains and majors, or O3s to O4s, in a leadership or command position, they do 50% admin and 50% doing. O5s and O6s in leadership positions are doing about 75% admin and 25% doing. And staff officers, O3s to O6s in staff positions, do 90% admin work, most of it in garrison, but some of it for a battalion, brigade, or division-level field training exercise. For a soldier,
the higher rank you get, the less time you're really going to be on the field because you're so high in leadership, you're pretty much watching over everything to make sure it goes down smooth.
And team leader in garrison, he spends 10% admin and 90% training. But an NCO, from squad leader to platoon sergeant, will spend about 25% of his time doing admin duties and 75% of his time training. Like a young lieutenant platoon leader, this is about as good as it gets. A first sergeant is like a company commander, so they do 50% admin, 50% doing. Command sergeant...
My first sergeants were always everywhere. Like, where is the first sergeant? He is somewhere doing something. Nobody really knows what it is, but he's doing it.
So they do 50% admin.
Whether he's out in the field giving MREs to soldiers driving around the field, or he's in the garrison command center saying, oh, our guys are doing this here, this and that. Like, bro, first sergeant is everywhere.
50% doing.
Crazy.
Command sergeant majors are like battalion commanders. All right, so they do 75% admin, 25% doing.
Yeah, admin, administrative work, sergeant major is somewhere doing something. You see where I'm going with this? They're somewhere doing something and you don't know. You'll see the first sergeant more than you see the sergeant major, but sergeant major shows up every here and now and then, and it seems like he's like, oh, I'm just checking on you. I could send somebody down here to check on you, but I want to do it myself. Oh, you guys are doing good. All right, I'm out. At ease.
And heaven forbid an NCO gets stuck on battalion, brigade, or division staff.
Never
they will
it.
Similarly do 90% admin.
I've seen them be there on staff duty, but I've never seen them do staff duty. I have never seen that
work. Unlike officers who might spend half their career on staff, a lucky NCO only spends one or two rotations on a staff during their career. And some NCOs never do staff time.
What?
So let's do a roll up. If you're the kind of person who thinks that that's training, wild, deploying, and field time is harder, then the NCO career is much harder. But if you're like most people who want to jump out of airplanes and shoot guns, then an officer's life is harder in that it requires more staff time and more time being a staff geek.
I'm guessing he's talking about his audience because I know a couple people that didn't want to jump out of planes. They really just wanted to get the benefits and get out.
With the exception of staff officers and NCOs at higher headquarters who make plans and enable operations, when members of a combat arms unit are deployed, they finally get to do what they're trained to do. There are a lot of ways to describe this. Some call it trigger time, chopping wood, being operational, doing ops, going on a mission, or being outside the wire. For sure, the soldiers and NCOs will
bro, I ain't gonna lie, they made the press guy look cool as shit.
or being outside the wire. For sure, the soldiers and NCOs will do the most fighting. But junior officers also get to spend a lot of time outside the wire.
That's true.
For the most part, the officer plans and resources the mission, makes tactical decisions during the mission, communicates with higher, and orchestrates the fight.
Yeah, like 01 through 2 could be out there in the actual battle with you, not on the front line, but like right behind you pretty much, relaying orders. On the not even really on the, he can be on the radio, but other enlisted would also have radios like the NCOs. But the O3s can definitely also be in the shit too. They're most likely like in between, like they're down the street. Like if you guys need backup, the O3 and them, they're just down the street. They can call more people up or they can relay to higher, like, hey, our guys are doing this, this, we need help here, this and that. If shit gets crazy, O3 puts on the kit and can actually do something on the front line. But higher than that, it'd be rare. It'd be like a absolute state of emergency if the damn Colonel Fulbert is out there sending rounds downrange. Like, that'd be absolutely crazy.
And then they send up collected intel and reports after the mission. I want to highlight that for all of my time in Special Forces, my team sergeant or my sergeant major was just as smart as me, just as capable as me, and understood the big picture just as well as me.
They have to.
But in every country we served in, the locals didn't want to coordinate with the master sergeant or the sergeant major. They wanted to coordinate with the officer. And so I will throw it out there that when deployed, the officer is also the unit's liaison, planner, spokesman, and networker. In my experience, when deployed, the job is harder and more demanding for officers, but more dangerous and physically demanding for enlisted.
It's a balance.
I used to think that it's better to be an officer than an NCO because the officer is in charge and the NCOs have to follow, do what I say. But the fact is that in the military, there's always someone who outranks you and who directs you. If you have a good boss who looks out for the men, then you are going to have the freedom to do what needs to be done to accomplish the mission. If you have a knucklehead for a boss, then you will have to endure their selfish and treacherous decisions and focus most of your efforts on protecting your men.
Oh my God, dude. Just the way he puts it, bro. They're treacherous, bro, 100%. Oh my God. Like, not even officers, but fucking NCOs as well. They'll put their career above everything. Bro, I got so many crazy stories for you guys, but this ain't the time for that.
Selfish and treacherous decisions, and focus most of your efforts on protecting your men. I see great soldiers and bad leaders so much more in the conventional army than in the special operations community.
Which makes sense, because special ops, you're getting weeded out from the best of the best. In commission, like, anybody could join as long as they pass basic training, they're in, and as long as they don't do anything crazy. And even if they do stuff crazy, like DUIs or getting busted during the UA or whatever, they could still get that shit swept under the rug. Maybe they lose rank, whatever. Maybe they lose pay, 90 days, whatever. They're still there. They're still being a nuisance. They're still being a burden. Why? Because they're a cog in the machine. And the machine is running out of cogs, so the ones that we do have, well, we might as well keep them around because we're not getting any new ones anytime soon. Yeah, there's a couple of teenagers straight out of high school that are like, yeah, I want to join the army. But a lot of people that join just get out. Either they get out on purpose or like their contract runs out and they don't extend or they get injured. But retention is very low, at least when I was in. Retention was very low. I don't see it getting any higher. Who knows? If another war breaks out, there's going to be a lot of patriots that want to sign up, just like after 9/11.
And bad leaders so much more in the conventional army than in the special operations community. But every village has an idiot. So don't think that by joining SOF, you are going to be free of ambitious or eccentric leaders.
Of course not.
Since officers and enlisted are all in the chain of command, it's everyone's responsibility to train and develop their leaders. I honestly think a platoon sergeant has a lot more influence on training and developing a newly arrived platoon leader than a company commander has when trying to set expectations and develop a newly arrived battalion commander. So in some
situations, I mean, if you're already a commander, you're like, okay, I can run stuff this way. And sure, you might get advice from someone higher, but it's like, it's been working out for me so far. Whenever you're a platoon sergeant and you're getting a bunch of new trainees, you might even delegate it down to team leader or squad leader or whatever. They're going to spend majority of their time around the NCO and squad leader and the team leader. It's going to just build them from who they are. So whoever that platoon sergeant is or that team leader is, that's just going to rub off on the new Joes. That just makes sense. And the company commander meeting some general or whatever, and you're getting a promotion.
Situations, it is better to be an NCO who gets to mold and mentor a lieutenant than a captain who must obey his lieutenant colonel. I remember being a very senior captain in a special operations task force in southern Afghanistan. My partner was a senior CW3 who gave me a lot of mentoring. Every Monday, we had a meeting with a SOTF XO, who was a nice guy, but a total wimp and administrative Nazi. The warrant officer, let's call him Bert, refused to let me go and sent a senior SF NCO instead. When I asked him why? Bert said, as a captain, you will write down everything that is said and do what the major asks of you. Bro. But next month, when you get promoted to major, you can argue back and tell him that his ideas are stupid.
Yeah, you hear that? It's like, oh, it's the rank. It's not about it. And like, yeah, you get promoted next month. You're still the same person, bro. You're still the same guy. All it is a different rank. So, and I get a lot of those people, they are fragile, right? They need that rank structure because as soon as somebody gets that power, they're like, okay, I can do whatever I want. If you're below me, I don't want you to say nothing to me because maybe they didn't get to say something to somebody higher, you know? It's a perpetual state of something like that where they keep doing bad shit to the next person that keeps on going.
But until then, let's send Sergeant First Class JJ. He is disagreeable and grumpy and no one likes him. There is no way the XO will give him a lot of extra work. The point of the story is that everyone has a chain of command in the military. Sometimes you win and sometimes you lose. Sometimes it's harder to deal with a bad boss as an officer than as an enlisted guy.
I don't know.
But most of the time, when you have a bad leader, the NCOs and the men suffer the most. So in this case, being enlisted is harder. Let's jump back to a junior officer being a tactical platoon leader. He does 25% admin and 75% training. Let's convert that 75 and make it 75 units of training, doing, of work. If he has a career like mine, then he will get 2 years of platoon leader time, 1 year of conventional company command, 3 years on a special forces team, and a year of soft company command. The other years he's on...
It's crazy how he's using his own career for, like, the standard, well, not even the standard, it's just like his way of teaching. It's like, bro, you are, if you're already SF, you're above standard, right? You're above and beyond the standard. So it's interesting to hear this, because there's gonna be a lot of young teenagers that hear this and they're like, oh, okay, I'll be able to do this, this, and this. Bro, unless you're a freaking beast and you're already training, I don't think you're gonna be able to match the uploader. I don't remember.
Staff, and that makes a total of 665 units of work. A soldier, as we said, does 90% for the first 3 years, and then is a squad leader through platoon sergeant, who does 75% for 13 years. He finishes off as a first sergeant for 2 years and 3 years on staff. That makes 1,465 units of work. So the officer does 665, and the NCO does 1,465 units of work. But this is just an arbitrary number. Now let's say that these units or these numbers represent missions, airborne operations, dives, long ruck marches, heavy body armor, and or potentially sprained ankles, sore shoulders and back, busted knees, purple hearts. I think you get my point. Some may see this as fun, and these are the people you want in combat arms and special operations. Others see this as hard, and these are the people who would better serve their country from a desk.
Behind the desk is good.
Rank has its privileges. I joined up as an officer and thought, this is going to be great. Rank has its privileges. And then we went to the field, and I got rained on and wet and tired and slept in terrible places just like my soldiers. But I also had the extra benefit of having to stay up late to plan and pull radio watch at the headquarters. I remember thinking that as a company commander.
Yeah. Oh my God, that just reminds me of a quick story. When we were in the field, bro, like, so we're in the field, we have radio duty, radio checks, and fire guard, and we switch it out every hour and a half or every 2 hours. But our officer, our lieutenant, he was sitting in the track, the armored vehicle with the radio. He was sleeping, you know, where the planning is. It's like a big metal desk. He had his sleeping gear there. He was sleeping in there, right? So he's on guard at the same time, because when I went to pull my guard duty, not even guard, like, you know, radio duty, a call came in, and I was a brand new private, so I like forgot what I was supposed to say on the radio. It literally took me 2 seconds to remember. Like, the radio went off, something over, and I waited like 2 seconds. He immediately woke up. He's like, Arrington. I was like, I did it. I was like, damn, like, what the fuck? Like, you're supposed to be, I thought you were asleep. Nah, he's half asleep. He is half asleep, but he's doing his fucking job, man. I think last time I saw, he's a captain, but I'm pretty sure he's a major or something now.
He'll watch at the headquarters. I remember thinking that as a company commander, I would get to enjoy the perks of being the boss and that my first sergeant would run the show. But it seemed like we both stayed late and worked more hours than anyone else. Yes, there were times when I had it easy and really enjoyed life. But for the most part, rank has its privileges is a fallacy. Really? If I were to say that rank has its privileges, the privilege is work and more responsibility.
More responsibility, 100%. More work, it definitely depends on the situation, the unit, and stuff like that. But yeah, I can understand that, because there's been times where, as a Joe, we ended up staying late because of some officer meeting, right? After we all get off and go home, of course, some of us have to stay behind for duty, whatever it is. But usually the NCOs are on call to come back and do something. And I never see the officers, so I'm guessing they're either there or they're also on call or they're not on call at all. I'm not too sure.
The higher I got in rank, the more difficult the problem sets were, and the harder I had to work to ensure that me and my men were safe and set up for success. I will say that when I went in for services, like to set up a transportation appointment or go to the clinic, I was for sure treated better as a lieutenant colonel than a lieutenant. But similarly, a master sergeant or a sergeant major gets treated better than a private.
Of course,
The takeaway here is that both officers and enlisted will work harder and have more responsibilities as you progress through the ranks. Service is about service. It's not about you. So you better set your mind to working. I want to finish our discussion with fun factor. I'll never forget an experience I had in Afghanistan when I was the future operations officer for the Combined Special Operations Task Force Afghanistan, or CJSOTF. It was about the 20th of December. Two lieutenant colonels showed up to my office and I was told to ensure that they had computers and access to any of my planning files. They were sent on a last-minute detail to make a special plan and were not allowed to return stateside until their plan was done and approved. These two lieutenant colonels were demoralized, depressed, on top of working like dogs as staff officers at Special Operations Command Central, or SOC Cent. They were given a no-notice trip to Afghanistan a few days before the holidays. Rise. Their wives and their kids were terribly disappointed.
Rise.
This was the first time I saw a Green Beret with a broken spirit. Being on staff and planning and typing on a computer had crushed these two men. I did the best to integrate these two men into our team and to make the most of it, but they barely endured the 3 weeks that it took to write and finish their plan.
I bet.
I tell this story to highlight that no one joins special operations to work behind a computer or to be a staff officer, but it is an inevitable certainty that all officers will do their fair share of staff time. And that time is miserable and soul-crushing. Although most NCOs get stuck doing some staff time, they do a year of it, not a decade, and some never do any staff time. So if I had to discuss what is harder when it comes to fun factor, being an officer is harder because it requires more time being a soul-crushing desk jockey and less time being an action guy.
I love how he puts it, man, but some people love being behind the desk. Some people live for it, but for you to go from behind the desk to, okay, we're about to pack up and leave so we can go home. And it's like, no, you got to stay longer. Also, yeah, you're not going back on Christmas. It's like, bro, what? Like, shit happens, man.
Okay, there you have it. A quick discussion about the differences between serving as an officer and service as an enlisted man. Please let me know which one would be a better fit for you in the comments below. Thanks for watching.
I want to be the warrant officer. I don't want to be around. can I be the warrant, please? Anyways, that was a very awesome and interesting video. If anybody's also joined the service, please know what was your position and what was your opinion on it. I got out as an E4 specialist. My time in was, I loved the Army personally. I loved it. It's just the leadership was messed up. Like, period. A lot of stuff happened. A lot of bad stuff happened. Like, bad shit happened and just got swept under the rug. And it's swept under the rug for reasons that are like, bro, we cannot have these people in here. But at the same time, you necessarily do need them because you're not going to get any more new people anytime soon. Like, I was there 3 years and I think we got new people two times. The first time was like a normal, hey, we got 10 people coming to the battery and they got spread out over four different companies, whatever, I don't remember. But then the second shipment was when we got our first females into the unit. So I don't think that one really counts because this was the first time females were graduating and becoming 13 series. So I don't think that really counts. I guess you could say it counts now if females and other enlisted are joining at separate times, but if they are joining at the same time, then say after a span of 3 years you get one, which ain't really that much. Like, you get people rotated in from like different units, stuff like that, like some people leave to a different unit, stuff like that, but a whole batch of new Joes to come in, that's like once in 3 years. It does make sense. You do kind of need them. You can't really hold them, but they be doing some messed up stuff and the consequences aren't necessarily always there. But, I mean, you could say that for any career. People in politics, people in McDonald's, you know, bad stuff happens, sweep it under the rug. I mean, but yeah, it's your boy, Miss Comrade Scrub. See you guys next time. Whoa, my outro's not playing? What? All right, whatever. I'll fix it later. Bye.